Hello everyone, this is Akshay and in this video we'll be covering event delegation. So event delegation is a technique of handling events in our web page in a better way. This is only possible because of the way how event propagate up the hierarchy in the DOM tree. Yes, the concept is event bubbling. So event delegation is based upon event bubbling. So just because event bubbling exists, event delegation also exists. So if you are not aware of what event bubbling is, then I would suggest you to go back to my YouTube channel and check out my last video of event bubbling. That will eventually help you to understand this concept very deeply and thoroughly. Generally, in our web application, when we develop, we have a lot of cases where we need to add events to our web page. Like, we need to handle those events. We have click events, we have a lot of events like input field, key up and clicks and a lot of random events. And as in when our application grows, these number of events keep on increasing and our web page keep on getting stuffed with all these event handlers. And at some point of time, we have a lot of event handlers just hanging around in our web page. And that is obviously a very critical performance bottleneck. So we should obviously avoid doing it. So that is why we use event delegation, and event delegation provides us a very awesome technique of handling these event handlers so that we don't have these event handlers hanging around in our web page and cause us performance bottleneck. So first of all, I would be using the whiteboard directly to explain you what event delegation actually is, and then we'll dive into the code and see how it works in the code and a lot of things. So suppose let us take an example of a web page where we have a lot of events. So let's take an example of an e-commerce site. So suppose we have an e-commerce site. And we have so many events around it, right? Inside this web page. Let's call them as, suppose we have a lot of categories inside this. So we can have these categories as laptops, and we have cameras, and suppose we have shoes, and similarly we have a lot more categories. And whenever I click on this laptop, it takes me to a new page with some different URL. Suppose this laptop takes me to something, our web page domain name /laptops. And similarly, the cameras take me to cameras. And inside that, we have a lot of other products and something like that. So we are just concerned about this web page and the events inside this. So these are individual HTML elements. Suppose this HTML element has an ID of laptop, and this element has an ID of camera. So what generally developers do is they attach some event handlers to this ID, something like document.querySelector, and in this query selector they will find out this laptop and then add event listener and the click and the callback function. So what they will do is they will attach such event listeners onto each and every ID or each and every individual HTML element. So, and then they will, to redirect them to these URLs, they will directly write window.location.href, or they will follow some similar pattern or writing on clips attributes inside these. And what basically I'm trying to say is, like, they will attach the event handlers inside each and every HTML element. That is not a good way to do, because this list can grow infinite. Like, if we have an infinite scroll and in the browser window, we don't know how many such elements exist. What will happen is, we will eventually be loading our page, and then suppose we have implemented lazy loading or infinite scrolling, then we would keep on adding events or keep on adding this child elements and individual elements into our web page, and we will keep on attaching these event listeners onto our web page. And after some point of time, what will happen is our page will be just having event handlers hanging around, and those can lead to much performance issues. So what is the better way to handle these? So the better way to handle this is by using event delegation. So event delegation states that instead of attaching event handlers onto each and every child elements or the HTML elements individually, we should rather attach an event handler to directly parent of these elements. So what did I mean by that is, suppose we had a parent of these elements, a div or something with some ID, suppose categories. So instead of individually attaching event listeners onto these, we will somehow try to attach a single event listener onto this div, that with the ID categories. And when a user is clicking on this laptop or cameras or shoes, what will happen is the event happening over here inside these child elements will bubble out to their parent and will bubble out over here, and the event handler attached over here will be triggered, and the callback function will be called for the event handler which is attached to categories. So instead of having so many event handlers, what we have now done is we have created a single event handler, and just because of the concept of event bubbling, our events are now being propagated up the hierarchy, and this parent is listening to all the events happening inside these child elements. So this is what the concept of event delegation is, and it can be achieved only because event bubbling is possible in JavaScript. So this is what theoretically event delegation looks like. Now let's dive into the code and check how we can actually implement that in our code, and when the events are propagating up the hierarchy, when the events are happening inside this individual element, how does parent come to know which of these elements are getting triggered? So all this we'll see inside the code. So let's not waste time over here. Just directly go and dive into the code so that we can get a better understanding of how this actually works inside code. Actually, that is what matters, right? So come, let's check the code now. So in this demo for event delegation, I would directly be starting from scratch, and so that you can follow up along with me how event delegation works. And I would be using the same example what I was explaining you on the whiteboard. So let's start doing that. So suppose we have a div, and inside that div we have an unordered list with an ID category. And inside that I have a li of ID, let's say laptops. So it will look something like this. So ID is category, inside that I have laptops. So let's give it some text, laptops. I have more li with the ID of cameras, suppose. Cameras. And one more li, let's take one more li with an ID of let's say shoes. So we have shoes. And so let's see how that looks on browser. So we have this laptop, cameras and shoes. And what we want to achieve is,
it's 21 hours.
And what we want to achieve is, suppose somebody clicks on laptop, so he should be redirected to /laptops/cameras or /shoes. So in a normal way, we could have solved this problem by attaching each and every li item with a event handler, which will listen to the click event, and then according to that click event, does something of window.open or window.location.href and navigate the user onto /laptop/camera/shoes. But in that case, we would have added 3 event handlers into our code, and those 3 separate event handlers would be handling these 3 LIs. What if suppose we have a lot of, like if you see any e-commerce website, we have a lot of categories in place. So they are not just 3, they could be hundreds, or in a web page, there could be
thousands of these LI items. So in that case, we would that would not make sense to attach each and every event handler onto each and every LI. So in that case, we will use the concept of event bubbling and how event propagates in JavaScript. So because of event bubbling, the event will propagate to this parent UL over here in this ID category, and attaching just a single event listener onto this ID category can help us achieve that. Let's see in the code how we can achieve it and how can we redirect them to laptop, camera or slash shoes. So let's see. So in my JavaScript file, I'm starting to write some code. So let's see, let's say document dot, let's use query selector to select our ID of category. And in that query selector, I would like to attach a event listener, which will listen to the click event and would have a callback function. In that we have a event. Now this event handler is attached to the ID of category. That means if we click on this category, or if we click inside this category onto any LI item or anywhere inside this category, we would get this callback function called. So let's see once how this looks in the browser. So let's just console log something. Category parent clicked something. Okay, parent clicked. And let's see this in action. So if I refresh my page and try to click on these, so it says category parent clicked. So that means if I am clicking on this laptop, it is the event is bubbling up the hierarchy and it is going on to the event listener attached to this category or its parent. So we can use this event listener to check which LI item is clicked. So let's see how we can check whether we were clicking on laptops or cameras or shoes. So that a good way to check is by using this E or this event object what we receive in this callback method. First of all, let us explore what's there in this E object what we get in our callback method. So let's try to log this E. If we try to log this E and refresh the page and click again, so this E is this object. It contains a lot of properties which are according to the click what we did on the browser, and it is giving us information about the click what we just did on the browser. So these are some of the data points which are collected by the browsers, and in that we can see something called as E.target. So this target over here refers exactly to the point or the element inside the hierarchy where I have clicked. So that means when I clicked on laptop, this E and the target inside it refers to LI and then target. Inside that target, you can see a lot of other things which can be used to detect whether which element we have clicked. So let's try to print E.target now and check what it looks like. So if we refresh the page and try to click on something, if I clicked on laptop, see, we got directly the element which was clicked, and this is done only by attaching a single event listener to its parent. So when we know the exact element where the click event is triggered, so we can use that element to detect which that element is can redirect that user to slash and then that event name, or we can call it as event ID. So let's first try to print e.target.id. So it gave us laptops over here. So it is directly giving us the ID. So now what we can do is we can directly write this code. Window dot location dot href equal to, and we can directly pass in slash and then the e dot target dot id. So what will this do is, let's see this in action. So what will it do is, if I click on laptops, it goes to slash laptops now. So that is what we were trying to achieve. Because we don't have any laptop page, so it gave me an error. But if I click on cameras, so it went on slash cameras. So this is what event delegation is, and it can be achieved through event bubbling. So whenever I am clicking on any of the LI elements, so let's see over here, if I clicking on any LI elements, the event is being bubbled up onto the UL or the parent of this LI element. And because a single event handler is being attached to this parent, it is listening to each and every click happening even inside its child. So it checks for the click event and then passes the E object. And from this E object in the callback method, we can check whether what was the target, actual target where that click was triggered, and we can take out the ID from it and we can redirect the user to that URL. So, but we have an issue over here. We should not directly redirect someone to any location directly like this. So what I'm trying to say is, suppose we had few more tags inside UL, or suppose we have some nested different elements, like apart from LI, we had different things. So what happened is, if we clicked on those element as well, the event will bubble up and the same callback method will be called and the user will be redirected to random URLs. So what we can do is, we will keep a check and will only redirect the user to a specific page when the e.target is actually a LI element. So we can keep this check of e.target.tagName. This should be equal to li, then only redirect us to slash e.target.id. That means if I refresh the page again, it is giving us the same behavior. Apart from this, one more awesome example just came to my mind. So let's explore that as well. Like, I would like to show you that example as well. And it is a beautiful technique of using event delegation. And it's a very beautiful example. So just hold on for a minute and I'll show you one classic example. Seriously, that is one more way we can use event delegation in our day-to-day life. So suppose if I had suppose a form or something, or inside a page, suppose we have a lot of input boxes. So this is what actually I have used, and inside that event, so if I have this input box with an ID of, suppose, let's say name or something, and again we have one more input box with an ID of, let's say, a PAN number or something, and we have, suppose, one more input box. Just hold on, I will show you one very good use case where we can use this. And suppose we have, let's say, mobile number as well or something. Okay, so what we can do is, so let's first of all see this, how this looks inside our browser. So it looks as the, what happened, add event listener. Okay, so I'll remove this for now. So okay, so what happens is, now if you look at the browser, we are seeing these three input fields. So we can type in something inside it. So suppose if I want to add a feature of making my name capital. So as in, when I am typing, the character should come up in uppercase. So we are trying to achieve that functionality. So let me show you with the code exactly. So suppose if you are aware of this data attribute, so what we can do is, we can create our own data attribute, data hyphen uppercase. So what we can do, so if this data hyphen uppercase attribute is present over here, so let's first of all try to identify which and which ID, which element over here has this data dot uppercase attribute. So how we can do it, let me just log this e dot target once again to you for your convenience. And if I try to log some event, okay, so we are getting E. So rather I would log E, and then if I type something in, so we got this E dot target. And if you clearly see this, so we will have something called as data set, and inside that we got a data set. So the data attribute which we set over here, data hyphen uppercase, it is present over here. So what we can do is any element over inside this div which has this data hyphen uppercase attribute should follow a functionality. So first of all, I will try to filter out these events which are only specific targeting that data hyphen uppercase elements. So we can have something like target dot dataset. So if this e dot target dot dataset dot uppercase is not equal to undefined, that means that this data hyphen uppercase attribute is present on that input box, then what we are trying to do is we are trying to replace this e dot target dot value with e dot target dot value dot to uppercase. That means if I click on this input box has a data hyphen uppercase attribute assigned. So what will happen is it will go inside this if case and will execute this statement. With this statement, we can achieve a functionality something like this. If I am typing my name inside it, it is actually making it in uppercase. So as in when I am typing, my name is getting in uppercase. So what I was trying to tell you by this behavior is, so we have made this functionality once, but we can reuse this functionality to any number of input boxes we want to. Suppose for now, if I am doing the same thing inside pan, so we don't get this feature or we don't get this behavior. This is known as actually behavior pattern, which can be achieved using event delegation. So these behavior patterns are very common and can be reusable. So if we wanted our mobile number, or mobile number is a bad example, if we wanted something, if this mobile number to also be in uppercase, we just had to attach a data hyphen uppercase attribute to it. That's it. And we could have attached and we could have achieved the same thing. So I think, okay, I didn't refresh the page. So we could have attached the same functionality for that as well. So what I was trying to tell you that we can make these small behavior just using event delegation, and we can use these behaviors in any number of child nodes we want to. So suppose our form is very long and has suppose 20 fields. So we won't be attaching each and every uppercase event handlers to each and every input boxes. Rather, we will create a behavior and attach that behavior like inside this data attribute, and we can get that functionality. So that is one of the good ways we can do this. And I hope you have understood this. And that's all in this demo of event delegation. So thank you for watching.
So now, after understanding what event delegation is, let us try to understand the benefits, or I would say it as the pros and cons of event delegation. So the first benefit of event delegation is actually memory. So what happens is, now when we are using event delegation, we need to attach only single event handler. So it saves a lot of memory instead of the memory what we have used while attaching a lot of event handlers. So that is the major and the most important benefit of event delegation. So it improves a lot in memory, and it also mitigates the risk of performance bottleneck. Second benefit of event delegation is writing less code. So while we are coding, we need to write less code to attach event handler onto the parent rather than attaching event handler onto all child and handling all of them separately. So other benefit is less code. The third benefit is DOM manipulation. So suppose we have this DOM over here, and we had this infinite scrolling. So and our elements inside this are dynamically added. So what will happen is, if we have attached each and every event handler onto separate HTML element, then it would become tough for us to add the element and then attach an event listener onto them. So rather, what we are trying to do now is we are attaching event listener onto the parent, and the childs are being taken care of apparently. So what happens is, if the new children are just adding up into the parent, it doesn't matter, because all these children will obviously be bubbling up or propagating the events up the hierarchy, and the parent is anyways listening. So that's another benefit of using event delegation. So these were the benefits of event delegation. Yes, but it has limitations too. So let's come on to the limitations now. So the first limitation of event bubbling is that all the events are not bubbled up. So let me tell you clearly, all the events are not bubbled up. Some events like blur, focus, resizing of the window, I think scrolling also, and there are a lot of events which are not actually bubbled up the hierarchy because like they have their own risk. So you can read a lot about them on the other blogs and all, but yes, there are events which are not bubbled up, but most importantly the common ones like click, key up and all these events are obviously bubbled up. So you don't have to worry about them. So, but keep in mind that some events do not propagate up the hierarchy and we need to handle them. So that was one of the limitations. So other limitation is, if you know that sometimes what we used to do was in the child elements, we used to call stop propagation and then stop the propagation at that point of time and the event does not bubble up. So if you are using stop propagation anytime in your code, then eventually that won't work. So to work, to let event delegation work, you need to not use stop propagation and let the events bubble up. So these were the two main limitations about it, and it's not just limitation, but it is just of kind of check what we need to do before implementing event delegation. However, I would suggest you to use event delegation wherever possible and optimize your web page as much as you can. So that's all for this video. If you have learned something from this video, then do give it a thumbs up and stay subscribed to my channel because I am coming up with a lot more new videos and a lot more new JavaScript concept which will open up your eyes and which will make you understand JavaScript very clearly. And it is not just important for interview questions, but it is also important being a JavaScript developer and writing the day-to-day code. So if you are using such techniques while writing code, you will obviously be improving yourself as a JavaScript developer and as well as the company which you are working for and the web app what you are building. So you will grow eventually. So stay subscribed to this channel and click on the bell icon to get all the notifications of the upcoming videos, and I would see you next time. And yes, if you have any suggestions for me or if you want me to cover any specific topic or any specific interview question, then just ping me on LinkedIn, Facebook, or just comment down below on this video and I would be happy to help you. So that's all for this video. Thanks for watching.